Great to be together for our online service today. We're going to be having Lord's Supper today in our service, and so in the following song that might be your opportunity to go and grab a piece of bread and some port or some juice. But shortly we will be having our first song, and I just want to quickly say happy birthday to Albert Lee, turning 90 yesterday. Let's enjoy our first song. Well, good morning, everyone. My name's Rob Sharp, and I'm the Senior Minister here at MAC. Welcome if you're joining for the first time online with us. And welcome to all our regular Zoomers from MAC. Great to be meeting together like this, even if we can't meet in person. And hello to those connecting on YouTube later on. We hope for everyone that this will be a really encouraging time meeting God in His Word. You see, today we're going to be celebrating the Lord's Supper together, and we're going to be remembering Jesus' death and His resurrection. We'll pray. We will praise God as we have done in song. And then we're going to hear God's word as He speaks to us. We're continuing our series from the book of Luke. And as we look at chapters 7 and 8, we're having a little series, if you like, looking at Jesus' greatness. And in particular, as we begin in chapter 7, looking at great faith. Now today, through our service, and in particular through the Lord's Supper, we're going to be reflecting on Ephesians chapter 1 and the many blessings that we have from God. So let me read from Ephesians chapter 1, beginning at verse 3. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing. For He chose us in Him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in His sight. In love, He predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with His pleasure and will, to the praise of His glorious grace, which He has freely given us in the one He loves. In Him we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that He lavished on us. So many blessings. Every spiritual blessing we need has been given to us by God through Jesus Christ. So, as we continue in our service, we're going to have some time for church news now. And as always, want to encourage you, make sure you're connecting through the Mac update on the email. But a couple of things to draw to your attention. Many of us have just begun being in lockdown these last 2 weeks, but some of our members have been in lockdown for some time. And so this is an opportunity for us to hear a hello to Mac from them. And so right now we're going to check out a video from two of our members at Mac.
Hi there at Mac. My name's Shane.
And this is, I'm Addy.
And we're regulars at the 9:30 service, but we're actually in lockdown at the moment, so we're not able to come along and meet at church in person. We have to Zoom. You might have seen my wife in there doing kids church, but for Addy and I, it's Zoom. So we'd just like to say hi. And Addy, have you got anything that you are thankful for?
Yeah, I'm thankful that we can still go to school and also do church on Zoom and still learn about God.
Great. I'm thankful that I'm teaching in a school where I can tell students about my faith in Jesus and share that with them, and hopefully that will plant seeds that might have ramifications in their life down the track for those kids who don't believe, and it might just be an opportunity to share that with students there who do already believe in Jesus. So Addy, is there anything that our brothers and sisters at Mac could be praying for you about?
Yeah, well, one of the main ones is that we can get back together at church so we can see our friends, have a chat, drink some coffee.
Yeah, right. Well, I'd like prayer for a couple of things. The first one is I'd like prayer in terms of planning my lessons, some wisdom in planning my lessons. I teach in an area where it's predominantly project-based learning, so the kids make stuff and they really enjoy that, and that's what they're there to do, is to make stuff. But I'm trying to deliver content online, and it's really difficult to engage students and to keep them focused and to make the lessons enjoyable when all they really want to do is get into the classroom and make stuff. And the second thing is I'd like prayer for my Year 12 students. It's been a really difficult past couple of months for them, just with the uncertainty. And also, it's still an uncertain time for them. They're not really sure what's happening with a lot of things, trials, exams, etc. And also, whilst they've been able to get some of their major work done, they've still been interrupted. So it's been a difficult time for them. So prayer for them would be really good. So we look forward to this all being over and being able to get back to church with you guys. But for the meantime, we'll just say hi on Zoom.
Well, thanks, Shane and Addy. Let's just quickly pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you so much that we're able to hear from them today. We think of them, we think of all of our MAC members that have been in lockdown for some time, as well as all our brothers and sisters who have been in lockdown through that time as well and not being able to gather as Christians. But in particular, we pray for Addy that you would give her patience as she waits to return back to church, but thanks that she can go to school. We pray for Shane that you give him wisdom as he seeks to teach his students, particularly doing the projects. And we especially think of the Year 12s. Lord, just that you would be their rock and their confidence. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. And the last bit for church news is that we would love to connect with you. Up on the screen you'll see there, we've got an email. If you've got comments or questions, please fire them through on the info@midang. But also, if you've got prayer requests, then we would love to hear from you. In particular, we want to encourage you as MAC members to be thinking about making use of the prayer network. It's a great way. If you've got prayer requests, you just send in the email and it gets sent out to all those who've committed to praying in response to those emails. And if you'd like to be a part of the prayer network, then please email prayer network and we'll be able to add you to that list. And it's a wonderful and powerful way for us to partner together as a Christian community. Well, that's it for church news. Let's continue in our service. Now, I have one other thing for church news, and that is in the MAC update, I do want to encourage you to read the interview by James Knight, who is our new high school scripture teacher in Bowral and Mossvale High School. I'm sorry that his name is not in the interview there that he had, but it's James Knight, and it'd be really encouraging to read about that. Now, as we now have a prayer time, we're going to be praying a prayer of preparation, which is exactly what it says. It's about preparing our hearts. And as you see it on the screen there, I want to encourage you, I'm going to read it through slowly so that it can be a time for us to prepare our hearts for our service today. So let's reflect on these words and pray together. Almighty God, you know our hearts, and nothing can be hidden from you. By your Holy Spirit, cleanse our thoughts and desires so that we may truly love you and bring honor to your name through Christ our Lord. Amen. I'm going to pray the collect for today. Let's pray. Grant, O merciful God, that your church, being gathered in unity by your Holy Spirit, may show forth your power among all peoples to the glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, for ever and ever. Amen. As we continue our time for prayer, Sam is going to come and lead us in prayer. And then we're going to have a video from our Archbishop, Kanishka, leading us in prayer for Afghanistan. And then we'll join in saying the Lord's Prayer together.
Please bow your heads with me in prayer. Psalm 46:1-3 says, God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. He says, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. Heavenly Father, thank you that we can be meeting online today to hear from your word and to encourage one another after the service. Pray that you'll help us to be continuing to think through your vision, and I pray that you'll help us as we continue to meet together online. And Lord, we thank you for the encouragement that we have through our unity in Christ, the comfort of his love and the partnership we have in the Spirit. As a church community, we ask that you would enable us to be single-minded, having the same love, spirit, and purpose as we pursue our vision and mission. And we ask this so that we can be used by you to grow your kingdom and to bring you glory. We continue to pray for the appointment of a new assistant minister. We thank you that interviews will be able to be conducted last Saturday before the lockdown extended into our area. We pray that you will continue to guide the interview panel and the applicants during this process, that you will bring us a godly and gospel-hearted and grace-filled man to partner with us. And Lord, we thank you for James Knight and his work with High School SRE at Bowral and Mossvale High, sharing the message of Christ with students there. We pray that they will be continuing to grasp a good grasp on the Gospel of Matthew, as James has been teaching that to them, and that they will continue to think through the message of what Jesus means to them, particularly during this lockdown. And we pray that they'll be looking for you for comfort. And Heavenly Father, we pray that you will give wisdom to the missionaries and their sending organizations as they navigate this tricky time of COVID. We pray for the many missionaries who have returned home, that you will sustain the ministries they have been working in, and that you will help them to readjust to life in their home country, having left behind communities and people that they love, and with many of them uncertain of what the future might look like. We also pray for those who are still in the field, that you will help keep them safe, Lord, and please give them opportunities to continue sharing the good news of the gospel with those around them. And Lord, we pray for Follow Primary and Follow Youth, that the kids and youth will continue to meet online with us and to hear from your word. Pray that you'll continue maturing them as followers of Christ. And Lord, we pray for those that are isolated and sick at the moment, for those in our church community that are struggling with the isolation. We pray that they'll know your presence and your peace, Lord. And we pray that you'll continue to strengthen us all in this. And Lord, we pray especially for the Year 12 students who are facing online exams and the loss of many significant moments that normally take place, Lord. We pray for Christian Year 12 students to grow in faith, hope, and love in Jesus through this challenging and uncertain time. And we pray for parents of Year 12 students that they will be wise and patient as they support their children. Pray all this in your name. Amen.
This week we've witnessed the overthrow of the government in Afghanistan and the assumption of power by the Taliban. There have been scenes of terrible desperation and chaos. Afghan people, including many who've come to Australia as refugees, are in great distress. We've heard the voices, especially of women who are afraid and uncertain of what their future holds. Australia has been involved for 20 years in the effort to establish stable and peaceful life in Afghanistan. We know too that Christians have been serving in aid and development, in health and education, and in seeing the Lord's Church built. For the families of the 41 soldiers who gave their lives in Afghanistan, and for soldiers who returned from there, bearing the scars of war, and their families, these have been days of anger, grief, and disbelief. Australian forces at the moment are seeking to evacuate Australians from Kabul, as well as Afghans who were essential in the effort of Australian troops. In Psalms we read, "The Lord comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with equity. The Lord reigns. Let the peoples tremble. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. The Lord redeems his servants. None who take refuge in him will be condemned." Let us pray. Almighty God, creator and preserver of our world, we pray today for peace. Have mercy on our broken and divided world, and banish the spirit that makes for war. We ask that leaders of nations and governments will pursue freedom, justice, and the welfare of all people. We pray especially for all affected by the escalating turmoil and tragic events in Afghanistan. Help the leaders of nations to protect the vulnerable and to establish justice and peace. Restrain the forces of evil and protect men and especially women and children from Taliban forces. We also pray for Christian brothers and sisters in Afghanistan. Preserve their lives and strengthen their witness in this land of deep spiritual darkness and despair. We pray for Afghan refugees who have made Australia their home, and for those who are anxious about family in Afghanistan. Comfort them, we pray, and may they find hope and peace in their distress, in the knowledge of your Son, our Lord Jesus. And we pray, Father, for the veterans of our Defence Force who have served in Afghanistan and their families. Sustain these men and women who have served our country. May they receive the care and support they need at this time of disappointment and discouragement. Heavenly Father, in an uncertain world, please turn the hearts of all people to your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and to the peace that passes all understanding. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for praying.
Let's continue praying with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We have a time now to be reminded, to remind our souls, if you like, from Colossians chapter 1, that Christ reveals God, that Christ rules all, and that Christ has reconciled the universe to God. And so I'm going to read through Colossians chapter 1. I invite you, if you'd like to say it together, let us declare what we believe. Christ is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. All things were created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Amen. As we come to prepare ourselves now for the Lord's Supper, Let us hear what Paul says. Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. At the heart of the Christian life is an active trust in the Lord Jesus Christ and his sacrificial death for sin. So in this symbolic meal, originating from Jesus' Last Supper with his disciples, we get to express and strengthen our trust in him as we eat and drink with our brothers and sisters in Christ. The Lord's Supper is an outward and visible sign of the grace shown to us in the death of our Saviour Jesus Christ. As we share the bread and the juice, we're invited to feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. We're faced again with God's love for the unworthy, us. And we're also strengthened by faith in the one whose body was given and whose blood was shed for us. And so come then with heartfelt repentance and genuine trust in the Lord Jesus, recognizing the significance of sharing in this way. And so I would say to you, if in good conscience it would not be right for you to participate in the Lord's Supper, then I urge you to use this time to reflect on Christ and what he has done for you and God's love for you. So let us come to a time of confession. In Acts chapter 17, verse 30, as Paul was speaking to the Areopagus, he says, "In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. And he has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead." And so, knowing the goodness of God and the times that we do fail to respond with love and obedience, let us confess our sins together. Confession will be on the screen. Heavenly Father, you have loved us with an everlasting love, but we have often gone our own way and rejected your will for our lives. We are sorry for our sins and turn away from them. For the sake of your Son who died for us, forgive us, cleanse us, and change us. By your Holy Spirit, enable us to live for you and to please you in every way, for the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Having confessed our sins, let us hear the words of assurance from God that we read in Psalm 103. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is God's love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. Amen to that. Up on the screen, there's going to be an opportunity for you to respond, and you can do that in your heart or out loud if you like. Your response is in bold. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. He is worthy of all praise. Let's pray. We praise you and thank you, Heavenly Father, for every spiritual blessing in Jesus our Lord, in whom we have the forgiveness of sins, the gift of your Spirit, and the hope of sharing in your glory. We who were once far away have been brought near by the blood of your Son. He loved us and gave himself for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Therefore, we lift our voices to praise you, saying together, "Glory be to God in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen." On the night before he died, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the meal, he took the cup, and again giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for these gifts of your creation and pray that we who eat and drink them in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, believing our Saviour's word, may be partakers of his body and blood. Amen. As we eat this bread and drink this cup together, we proclaim the Lord's death. We do this until he returns. Come, Lord Jesus, come. So come, let us eat and drink in remembrance that Christ died for us, and feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. So with the bread, take and eat this in remembrance that Christ's body was broken for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. With the cup, drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. We're going to have a prayer of thanksgiving now that'll come up on the screen, and I invite you to join me in praying this prayer together. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us in this hope that we have grasped, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Amen. As we come now to meet God in his word, let me lead us in prayer before our first two Bible readings. Gracious God, as the Bible is read and taught, deliver us from unbelief and disobedience. Help us to exhort and encourage one another, that none may be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. Produce in us the fruit of your Spirit for the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Thanks, Kathy.
I'll be reading the first reading for today from Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's, and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, and who does not lift up his soul to an idol or swear by a false god. They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God their Saviour. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, O God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, O you gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty, the Lord, mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O you gates. Lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is he, this King of glory? The Lord Almighty, he is the King of glory.
Our second reading today is from Luke chapter 7, beginning at verse 1. Luke 7, verse 1. When Jesus had finished saying all this to the people who were listening, he entered Capernaum. There a centurion's servant, whom his master valued highly, was sick and about to die. The centurion heard of Jesus and sent some elders of the Jews to ask him to come and heal his servant. When they came to Jesus, they pleaded earnestly with him, "This man deserves you to have you do this because he loves our nation and has built our synagogue." So Jesus went with them. He was not far from the house when the centurion sent friends to say to him, "Lord, don't trouble yourself, for I do not deserve to have you come under my roof. That is why I did not even consider myself worthy to come to you. But say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I myself am a man under authority, with soldiers under me. I tell this one, go, and he goes. And that one, come, and he comes. I say to my servant, do this, and he does it." When Jesus heard this, he was amazed at him. And turning to the crowd following him, he said, "I tell you, I have not found such great faith, even in Israel." Then the man who had been sent returned to the house and found the servant well. Well, as I said earlier, we're continuing in our series through the book of Luke. And this little section, 7 and 8, we're really thinking about Jesus' greatness. As we worked our way through Luke, we've seen and heard about Jesus, and he really has revealed himself to be the Son of God. And so that's why last week, as we got to the end of chapter 6, Jesus was calling us to humbly listen to him, to humbly build our lives on the rock. And as we continue through Luke, that's what we need to be doing, build our life on the rock that's Jesus. So let's pray. Let's pray together that we will hear God speak to us. Heavenly Father, help us today to know Christ so that we are made more alive with Christ in our hearts and with our hands, in our minds and with our mouths. We pray that as we heard in the psalm, that we would lift up our eyes and see the face of our King this morning, that we would be like the gates of the city, welcoming in and praising our King into our hearts, our minds, and our lives. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. There was a tightrope walker named Charles Blondin, very, very famous. In June 1859, he wanted to be the very first man to cross on a tightrope Niagara Falls from America to Canada. And so with a 2-inch rope spanning 335 metres, this was the day. 25,000 or more people had gathered, and before he actually stepped onto the rope, there was huge doubts. The betting against him was pretty significant. But as he walked across and got to the other side, it was filled with deafening cheers. Blondin went on to walk across on stilts on the tightrope. He rode a bike across. At one point later on, he even got out a stove, took it out to the center, and cooked an omelet, which he then lowered down from the rope to the boat at the bottom of Niagara Falls. But what really set it apart was the day that, having crossed over to the Canadian side, he came back with a wheelbarrow, like the one pictured there. It was full of rocks, but he still made it across. And as he got to the other side, there was great cheering, as there always was. Everybody quietened for Blondin to say, "Do you believe that I could carry a person in this wheelbarrow across to the other side?" And overwhelming, the cheers were, "Yes, yes, yes." And so as he got the crowd quiet again, he said, "Who is willing?" Deafening silence. No one was willing to get into the wheelbarrow. It's a bit like the question that Jesus is putting to us today. Who is willing to trust me? You see, like the story with Blondin and like in Luke 7, faith in greatness leads to great things happening. And so Jesus is going to show us today, show you and me, how we can have great faith. And the big message for us to take home, oh, well, you're already at home, to live out today is this. That great faith is knowing that you don't deserve anything, but trusting that Jesus can do anything. I'll say it again. Great faith is knowing that we don't deserve anything from Jesus, but trusting that he can do anything. And so as our story begins, we start with the request. The request from a very unlikely person. That's the point that we're supposed to get here, because there's a bit of a cultural thing going on. This man is clearly a Roman centurion. So he is an enemy of the Jews, an enemy of God's people. But he's also a Gentile, a non-Jew. He's not one of God's chosen people. And so Jews were not supposed to interact. They certainly weren't supposed to go to Gentiles' homes. But he has a servant that he values. And he does, and this servant's going to die. And so he makes it possible for him to get a request to Jesus. But the tension point here is, will Jesus do it? He should keep his distance. But Jesus has just said in his teaching, just in chapter 6, verse 27, that we are to love our enemies. What will Jesus do? Well, the sent elders, as we read in chapter 4, say this. When they came to Jesus, they pleaded earnestly with him. This man deserves to have you do this because he loves our nation and has built our synagogue. For the Jews, it's all about deserving. It's like they feel like they've got to twist God's arm or Jesus' arm. Yeah, after all, he is a Gentile. Come on. Is this how Jesus works? How he responds to people or not? In that hold your breath moment of what will Jesus do, we read in verse 6, Jesus went with them. Jesus is willing to cross the distance. We're going to think a bit more about that in a moment. But what we see here, Jesus is willing to cross the distance even for the undeserving. For the undeserving, which is exactly what the centurion knows about himself. Have a look with me at verse 6. He was not far from the house when the centurion sent friends to say to him, Lord, don't trouble yourself, for I do not deserve to have you come under my roof. That is why I did not even consider myself worthy to come to you. The centurion's eyes are wide open to Jesus, to see Jesus. Unlike the Jews, it's all about what they think they or this man deserves. He sees that he is unworthy of Jesus, unworthy to see him, unworthy to even ask anything himself of Jesus, unworthy certainly to even have Jesus come under his roof. Like I said, the Jews think about that being a good person or deeds or religion is what matters. But what it really shows is that they're trusting in either themselves or what they do. That's like us when we trust in ourselves. But remarkably, the centurion says in verse 6 there, but say the word, and my servant will be healed. This is remarkable. Just say the word. But what we're meant to see here is that he never would have asked Jesus to do such an incredible thing. Just say the word from wherever you are. He never would have asked that if he thought he deserved Jesus to come to him, that he thought he deserved for Jesus to do this for him. You see, it's important we see that it's only when we know we are undeserving that we will actually ask Jesus to do great things, greater things than we would imagine. The other thing that I think is worth noting, the other insight from this passage for us is that he had faith that Jesus was willing. Having seen Jesus somehow, he knew that Jesus was willing to come even though he was undeserving. But instead of it being about himself, the centurion looked to the one who is the worthy one. He had faith in the worthy one. See, remarkably, he understands it's unnecessary for Jesus to come. He has power that overcomes distance. He has power to even overcome disease, even death. And he explains why in verse 8. That's why he says, "For," or "because, I myself am a man under authority with soldiers under me. I tell this one, go, and he goes. That one, come, and he comes. I say to my servant, do this, and he does it." The centurion understands authority, but it's deeper than that, isn't it? He recognizes Jesus' authority. Authority to command, authority of and power of his word. He gets the way that man's army works. And it seems so simple for him that God's army, God's king, would work just the same. Jesus has authority. Jesus' word has power. Verse 9, when Jesus heard this, he was amazed at him. And turning to the crowd following him, he said, "I tell you, I have not found such great faith even in Israel." I just imagine the disciples standing there going, "Hey, Jesus, we're standing right here." And Jesus goes, "Yes, I know." You see, the Jews, God's chosen people, they should have seen. They should have recognized his authority and power. But it actually took an outsider to demonstrate great faith. I think what we're seeing here is it's more than just knowing in our heads that Jesus has power and authority, but actually a trust that is willing to commit ourselves. The centurion was willing to commit the life of his valued servant. We need to be willing to commit our lives to Jesus when we see that he is the worthy one. In 1859, Charles Blondin was doing a number of different tightrope performances, but again, back at Niagara Falls, in August, Harry Colcord, his manager, agreed to ride on Blondin's back, like a piggyback, across Niagara Falls. This is what Harry Blondin said to him. Charles Blondin said to Harry, "Look up, Harry. You are no longer Colcord. You are Blondin. Until I clear this place, be a part of me, mind, body, and soul. If I sway, sway with me. Do not attempt to do any balancing yourself. If you do, we will both go to our death." That's calling on great faith. And I love this idea of him just becoming one. And that's exactly what faith is. Great faith is a commitment to the greatness of Jesus. Our mind, our body, our souls to him. And so the question from our passage today that we as followers of Jesus need to be asking ourselves is, do we trust Jesus' power? Do we trust his authority so that we are asking great things of him. Are you and I asking Jesus to do great things? See, this is what's essential for great faith. Great faith. Now, I'm usually reluctant to talk about the idea of us having great faith because I don't want to give the wrong expectation. So that sort of some burden of, oh, it's on us to have great faith. But this is a really helpful passage to help us to understand how to have great faith. And in particular, Jesus is the one, it's his words who describe this man's faith as great faith. So I think it's really important for us to think this through. And firstly, I think what we need to see is the dangers or the obstacles to great faith. The danger is thinking it's about what we deserve. What we deserve. You know, there's a couple of ways that this can go wrong. Like the Jews thinking of deserving. We need to be careful because if we think it's about what we deserve, well, then we're going to be disappointed with God when life doesn't go the way that we think it should, the way that we want, the way that we told God that it should go. Because in a sense, that's a mind that says, I've done a deal with God. If I do this, he should do this for me because I deserve that back. Much like the second brother in the story of the prodigal son. Another way of the danger of deserving is if we think it's about what we deserve, but we kind of don't think we deserve much, well then, sure, we don't think we deserve bad things, but we're probably not going to think that we deserve good things, let alone great things from God. And so we end up kind of doing nothing. We don't ask him for anything. That's the danger if we think it's about what we deserve. See, if we ask God to give us what we deserve, that's all we'll get. And it may not be good. But Jesus is saying, I want to give you so much more than that because it's not about what you deserve. The centurion is a great example. He never met Jesus. In fact, there were reasons for him not to even come and ask Jesus. He was an enemy. He was a Gentile. But it was actually knowing that he was undeserving. But trusting that Jesus was worthy of his faith. That he asked more than he could ever have expected he deserved. That's exactly what we need to do. So that's what we will do when we know that Jesus is worthy of great faith. This week, Christians around the world have been praying for Afghanistan under the control of the Taliban, praying for our brothers and sisters in Christ, praying for women and children in particular. And as I've read various things, I've been struck by the faith of Christian pastors. Yes, they are afraid for their families, and rightly so, and for their people in their churches. But they're still asking for prayer, that they would be strengthened in their faith, that they would stay strong in the Lord, as one wrote, who is the sovereign Lord, sovereign King. That's great faith. And they're also praying in these very dark days, remarkably, they're praying for revival. Instead of being overcome by the powers of darkness, they are praying that God would pour forth his light. That's great faith. I want to have great faith. I know I've had moments of it in the past, but I want it more and more. And I believe that every Christian wants great faith, just like the centurion, that your souls will have been longing as you've read this, heard this story, going, yes, that's what I want, more and more. But I struggle to have great faith. Just this last week, I was getting anxious about the whole process with us recruiting an assistant minister. Just how long it was taking, the uncertainties of how it's all going to work out, the burden of the decision that I've got to make. And then on Tuesday morning, as I sat down to have my cuppa with Jesus, opening up the Bible and praying, God spoke to me through his word, and he just reminded me Christ is the head of the church, as we heard from Colossians before. And in fact, Christ is the one who gives ministers to his church as gifts to build up the body. He's in control. And just seeing Jesus truly changed everything. It's trusting in Jesus is how we have great faith. And it's actually trusting in Jesus for the answer is how we express that, yes, we're undeserving, we're being humble there. Instead of getting the answer that we want, means coming to ask Jesus to give the answer that he knows is best. That's faith. See, great faith isn't just for some special Christians. It comes by seeing Jesus, looking to his face. It comes by knowing Christ. That's our vision. These roots are all about knowing Christ deeper and deeper so that the rest of the tree has life and bears fruit. Because when we look at Jesus and we see his face, we'll see that he is worthy of great faith. We see so many storms in life, don't we? But if we look to Jesus, we'll see him standing up and saying to the storms, "Be still, and know that I am God." We see in life so many different paths, and we can be so uncertain about it. But if we look to Jesus, we'll see that he's just leading us down one path, the one that is guaranteed to bring us into life to the full. We see the lost multitudes, and we're either overwhelmed or afraid to speak to them. But if we look to Jesus, we will see that he does not leave one single lost sheep out there. And at the same time, he is gathering this incredibly great harvest to join him in heaven. We see the grave, but when we look to Jesus, he shows us that it's an open door to eternal life with him. That's how we'll have great faith, you and I, when we see Jesus. Our personal Bible reading is so important in knowing Christ more and more. And then we'll ask great things. And today's passage is such an encouragement to us when we think about sharing Christ, also part of our vision, the fruit of our tree. Because what we see in Jesus in this passage is he has the authority to heal with just words. Distance, no obstacle. Disease, death, no obstacle. That's the power of the gospel to bring that healing, to have that authority. And we also see that Jesus is willing to cross boundaries. He died on the cross for our sins so that we could be saved. That's the power of the gospel. That's why we can ask Jesus to do great things saving people. Because faith, great faith, is knowing that we don't deserve anything, but that Jesus can do anything. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for Jesus, for his willingness to go and cross those boundaries because of love. But we also thank you for his authority and power, that with just words, he can bring such healing and has life-giving power. And so I pray for each one of us today that we would see Jesus, we would look to his face, and we would see, yes, how unworthy we are, but also how worthy he is of great faith. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Here at MAC, we have the wonderful opportunity to be in gospel partnership together, and one of the ways that we express that is through our financial giving. And so I'm going to give thanks for the offertory, and then I'll lead us in our closing prayer. So let's pray and give thanks for the giving, whether that be electronically or through the cash. Heavenly Father, thank you that we have these gifts to share. Help us to be generous in supporting the work of the gospel here at MAC, into the Highlands and to the nations. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I invite you now to pray with me for our brothers and sisters in Christ as we commit one another, as we go out to serve. The prayer will be on the screen. To him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Saviour, be glory, majesty, power and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. We're going to have our final song together now. And so I invite you to join and sing with your souls, and you at home can sing out loud. Well, I hope it's been an encouraging time for you as we've met God in his word this morning and been able to respond with prayer and praise and celebrate with the Lord's Supper together. We've been reminded today through Jesus that great faith is knowing that we don't deserve anything, but that Jesus can do anything that we ask. So let's get busy asking him to do great things, hey? We're going to continue having a time of fellowship over the Zoom for those who'd like to be able to connect with each other and to care for each other. So hang around, you might like to grab a cuppa, and then Kathy will be able to talk us through or talk everybody through.